Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I come to give you a message today on this Sunday, the resurrection day of our Lord. Bring a message in love, brothers and sisters. The Lord has sent me to bring a message in love. You know, brothers and sisters, since I started in the ministry, that was in the year I answered the call and came back from a backslidden state in the year 2000, October 2000. Then I began to publicly teach Sunday school January the 7th. I think it was, or January the 6th, whatever that, I think it's January the 7th or 8th, the first Sunday in January 2001, by the grace of God. And then I did my first public sermon there at the church, a Baptist church. That was the last, it was the fifth Sunday, I do believe, the last Sunday night in February 2001, brothers and sisters. And I had started because the relatives that I have that are Christians are all Baptist. So, of course, when I came back to the Lord in October, I was totally open. You know, I'd heard all those things. Oh, the King James is the only Bible to use and all that kind of stuff I'd heard. Went to vacation Bible school as a child and all this. But, brothers and sisters, really the secret to walking with the Lord is to... the Lord has given me this awesome summation message of a message and my calling from the Lord to really to Baptist brothers and sisters. My main calling is to Baptist. And well, it also into religious people in the Pentecostal denominations too, of course. Okay, the Lord has given me so much information. Some of it's funny and some of it, you know, is kind of humorous and also awesome. So I'm just trying to decide where to begin, brothers and sisters, but my own testimony, and that's what I'm doing. So, what I did, brothers and sisters, when I came back to the Lord in October 2000, is I took everything I'd ever heard about God and just threw it away. As far as not Christianity, of course, Christianity, but I threw away all religion, all traditions and religion that had been handed to me that I'd heard. But thank the Lord, I mean, I only went to church, vacation Bible school every several summers growing up. I only went, you know, when they had some kind of revival, I went here and there. So I wasn't religified, you know, I wasn't full of religion and indoctrination and doctrines of men. Thank the Lord, you know, and I know the Lord knows each of us and he calls us at different places and different ways. And thank God for that, you know. So if you want to know what your destiny is in God, if you're a brand new Christian today, or you've been a Christian 20 years, you look back and see the things you came through. As I've mentioned before, I'll say a woman who had an abortion as a young woman, and she, it ruins her life or devastated her life. And then, you know, the Lord is the one who came and delivered her from that, healed her from that, gave her forgiveness and grace from that. She's healed and delivered. Then the next thing you know, the Lord would use you, you know, to minister to young girls who are pregnant, unwed teens who are pregnant and things like that. Or other women who had an abortion 20 years ago and need recovery and deliverance and forgiveness and mercy and, you know, from that. Those kind of things. That's just an example. You know, suppose you've been in prison. You know, the Lord would use you in a prison ministry. Alcoholism. You know, dealing with recovering alcoholics or you know, to receive the grace and deliverance from alcohol. All those things. So, you know, we can see a clue to where we've been. God, you know, predestines us, if we're going to be a Christian, who will say, you know, the Lord foreknew, the Bible says, you know, he foreknew us, who would say yes to him. And he foreknew that you would say yes to being saved. He foreknew you that you'd say yes to being used by him and heal it, you know, to pray for people to be healed or whatever, you know, or to pray with people who were alcoholics. And the Lord, you know, knew that from the beginning that you would be an alcoholic for 20 years, 40 years, and then later on, you would come back to him and he would use you. So all of those things. That's a separate message. Anyway, brothers and sisters, this is my Sunday service. By the grace of God, you can go, you know, you can have church any day. I'm making, you know, most people, Sunday is the day because Jesus rose on Sunday. Any day of the week is fine. That's a whole nother sermon. Every day we should honor the Lord. Every day we should give time to the Lord. It's nice. And I believe the Lord, intention of the Lord for us in the natural is to select a day. And Saturday or Sunday is the best days. People are off. Most people are off work. And if you work on weekends, I used to always work on weekends when I was in the medical field. And then, of course, where I used to work at, too, at this place, Johnson Controls, and make car batteries, I work every other weekend. So, you know, you can make your day Wednesday, Tuesday, whatever. Another sermon. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I threw all religion out. And I said, hey, I just want to know Jesus. I want to know the Lord. I began to read the New Testament. I didn't go back and try to read the Old Testament prophecies and read myself in that I was Elijah and all this kind of stuff. Lots of new people are like that. Then you think, hey, they're getting loopy, man. They think they're Elijah and everything because, hey, they got saved yesterday, and then tomorrow they're going to Israel and they're going to wear a prayer shawl and a yarmulke and they're Elijah, you know. Anyway, that's a whole nother sermon. Anyway, so, the Lord is keeping me on this. You know, this is a summation of my ministry right here, this video I'm making. Thank God the Lord has just put a, you know, a capstone, you know, because, I mean, the rapture could be tomorrow. It could be, you know, the Lord only knows when it is. But I want to, you know, the Lord has given me this capstone to put out. This is a capstone of my ministry to religious people, to Phariseeism and religion, religiosity. Okay. And a balance. There's two different balances that the Lord always uses me with. And this balance, what I'm talking about, is being rooted and grounded in the Word. That's the theme of what I'm talking about here. Being rooted and grounded in the Word and the Spirit. You know, you have to have, you can't be so rooted in the, you know, so rooted and grounded that you know, they sing, I cannot be moved, I shall not be moved. But the Lord, it can't even be moved by the Lord. So, I consider myself, and that's what I used to say when I first started, brothers and sisters. I'd get up there in that Baptist church. I taught the adult Sunday school in the sanctuary, you know, from the first week Sunday in January 2001. And I began to say, hey, I'm a truth seeker. You know, all the people in the audience, I mean, if I'd have known what I knew now, I was ignorance is bliss, right? I was brand new. All the people in there have been going to that church and all have been saved for 20 years. Every week the pastor got up there and did evangelism. You know, John 3:16 is salvation. I'm glad I'm saved. Amen. We're all saved. Everybody else is going to hell but us. Amen, amen, amen. You know, preaching to the choir, same old message. You know, salvation by grace over and over and over again. And no, no growth, no other doctrine. You know, most, and the sad part is most of you guys would be happy to have that. Today, most churches aren't preaching that. Most of your churches are preaching them, you know, to worship Mother Earth. That's what they're going for. That's a whole other sermon that the Lord gave me about worshiping Mother Earth and getting up there preaching about the environment and all that stuff. And ultimately, it leads to worship of Gaia and Mother Earth. And that's going to be part of the end times, the way they're going to fund the New World Order. They wrote books in the 1960s, Kissinger and Rockefeller and all these guys, they wrote books in the 1960s saying, hey, we're going to fund the one world government, the one world new world order by a global carbon tax. And that's, and they invented Earth Day in 1970. And so they've been on a roll to bring in a global carbon tax to fund the Antichrist government. That's what it's all about. And then, of course, to try to be a slap in the face to God for people worshiping Mother Earth and exalting the creation over the Creator. That's another whole nother sermon. You know the Lord always puts me in pattern. Say, I'm on a pattern. I mean, that's one way I know it's the Holy Spirit, because the Lord had me in a pattern, those of you who watch my videos. So anyway, brothers and sisters, most of you, sad to say, would be happy if you went to a church that preached evangelism every week. But still, you know, we're supposed to be discipled and grow in Christ. So here I am up there, brothers and sisters, in my first time in the ministry. And I was a truth seeker. When I got saved in October, let me go back. Before I went to the Baptist church in January, see, that's 2 or 3 months. What I did during that time, brothers and sisters, I said, I don't know that King James is the right Bible. I'm going to go research and investigate. You know, I was able to get online at that time. I don't know if they had Google or not, but I went and looked and checked it out. And I read all I could. You know, I went to the Christian bookstore, which is now only available online. There's a big Christian bookstore there before called the Master's Law. And I went there, and things have changed so fast with technology. Now it's all online. Another sermon. Okay, so I went there, and I read. They had these little pamphlets about the different translations, which is the best. I listened to Christian radio. They talked about, they had some expert on there talking about translations and all this stuff. So I researched that. Then I went to a Catholic Mass. I went to a Methodist church, which I found was a lot more like the Catholic Mass than the Baptist church. Which is sad, since that was once a mighty denomination. It brought the first Great Awakening and the second Great Awakening to the United States. That's another sermon. But anyway, so the fall of these denominations. So I went around to all these denominations checking them out. You know, I went to a Pentecostal church, all this. And so then I decided that as I was reading my Bible, I was like, well, I can't find any churches that are doing what the Bible says, you know, I see in the book of Acts and all that. So, but you know, I know these Baptists, I know, you know, my relatives are Baptists. I'm going to go there. I'll connect with them because I know them. And then that's about as close as I can find to what I see in the Bible. I know they're teaching. I've discovered that the King James is right on, is really the best one in English. And, you know, I discovered that, you know, teaching salvation by grace through faith and all that. I was like, hey, I'm going to go there. And I didn't know about the once saved, always saved, and all that stuff. You know, I didn't know about the Holy Spirit or anything like that. I'd never seen, you know, in the Bible Belt, we have very few, you know, the Pentecostal churches are basically in the most poorest areas, even though, of course, I came from just an average family. But, you know, like 90% of churches are Baptist all across the South. You don't have much diversity. Anyway, I never even met any Catholics, I don't think, until I was grown, when I joined the Army. Anyway, so I went there to the Baptist church, and as I said, starting in January, after the New Year's, the next week, and then teaching Sunday school, and they let me do that, and I taught, and then the Lord just led me toward Spirit-filled kind of stuff, brothers and sisters, because I read in there about the gifts of the Spirit. I read about people being healed and all that. I didn't know any of that stuff. I was, because I'd only heard straight-up Baptist doctrine and salvation. I heard about the Baptists also have a good teachings about the end times, and some of the best scholars in end-time studies, eschatology, are Baptists, Southern Baptists, and different kinds of Baptists, like Dr. Tim LaHaye and all these guys. Dr. Ed Heinsohn, he's one of the best experts. Dr. Jack Van Impe came from a Baptist background, all these guys. So anyway, brothers and sisters, when I got there, the Lord led me. I prayed, because the good thing about this is an independent missionary Baptist church, and the pastor was like, teach whatever the Lord leads you, you know, which was awesome. That's more of a Pentecostal thing than a Baptist thing. So kind of Baptist-costal. So I prayed about it. Like I said, I was ignorant to the fact that all the people in my Sunday school class have been Christians for 20, 30, 40, 50 years. As a matter of fact, I guess there was nobody under 40 or 50 in the class. And here I am, you know, brand new, unchurched. And when I say churched, I mean, as I said, religified. So anyway, religiosity. So I went there, I prayed, and the Lord, you know, that's like one of the first things I saw kind of spiritually, you know. And in those days, I didn't know what was going on, so I didn't discuss it with anybody. But, I was like, people think you're crazy, because I had that Baptist mentality, you know. But if you go, brothers and sisters, just a side note, one thing I will say, lots of people, no matter what denomination they're from, if they're Christians, I'll talk to them privately. And they've had lots of spiritual experiences. They just don't share it. They're ashamed and embarrassed, and they keep it a secret. And then, you know, they have dreams and visions and all that stuff. You know, but yet these leaders, these wolves in sheep's clothing, these, you know, Pharisees are keeping it quiet, you know, and then they'll shun you and embarrass you if you start talking about it. So, anyway, but God speaks to all of his people, just, you know, some more than others, but he speaks to his people as we seek him. So anyway, I saw a vision of this book, the cover of a book to teach, because I was praying about what should I teach for Sunday school. So the Lord led me. I went to this Christian bookstore, the Master's Loft, and there was the book. I saw it because it was a blue cover like water and a big rock right in the middle. And then I got it. And the name of it was Faith. It was a work study book on faith by the father, Kenneth Hagin, Sr., the senior. Kenneth E. Hagin, I think it is. Anyway, so I got that book and I started reading, and you know, about you know, can be healed by faith and all this stuff, and that's what the Bible says. When you talk about like Mark 11, 22 through 24, go read that. It's another sermon. And I started teaching, and I was like, look, you know, why don't we have people getting healed in the church? I mean, why? You know, I was reading Acts. I read all that. I read, you know, reading the whole New Testament. I was like, well, I didn't see us praying for anybody to get healed. I mean, we know about salvation, but I don't see any. You know, it says, these signs shall follow those who believe. Mark chapter 16, you know, in my name they shall cast out devils. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. They shall speak in new tongues and all this. I was seeing all this. I was like, I didn't see any of this stuff going on. I mean, what's up? You know, what's up? And so the pastor, to his credit, is not a cessationalist. And most Baptist preachers are saying that the gifts of the Spirit ended when the Bible was finished being written. And they base it off the text where it says, you know, when I was young, I thought as a child, and you know, and all this, and where wisdom will cease, and knowledge will cease, and tongues will cease. But it says in there, when that which is perfect has come. And then it goes on to say, I will be known as I'm known. And then those same preachers use that text to say, when you get to heaven, everybody will know who you are. So that which is perfect will come is when the Lord returns, or when we're all in heaven. That's when that which is perfect will come. That's the end of the age. Not now, not when the Bible was finished written. And that's a whole other sermon. But from the I'm not debating with any of you Pharisees, so that's another video. But from the time the Bible was written until the time it was put together, and most people couldn't read and write, it's only until the last 100 or 200 years where the Bible was in the common language of all people. Well, for, you know, in America we were an exception, but most people in the world, you know, the public schools in the U.S. have only been around since late 1800s or whatever. Okay, so tons of people couldn't read. The vast majority of people couldn't read in the whole world until the last 100 years, and then have the Bible in their own language and all that. So all those people that lived during all that time, they didn't have the Bible anyway, you know, especially during the Dark Ages, you know, and then the Bible wasn't even put together and handed out and say, oh, here's the Bible as a canon of Scripture until 385 AD. Okay, so there was all that time. And then no one, 99% of the people couldn't read or write, so they couldn't have read it if they wanted to. And then it was, and by 600 or 700, the Catholics had tried to destroy all copies of the Bible except for Latin, and made it illegal for anybody to read it but the priest or the royalty of these countries. That's really why we had the Dark Ages. Not a darkness of technology, but a darkness of the light of God in the world. It was restricted by Babylonian religion, the ancient Babylonian mystery religion, who wear that daggone fish hat. That hat that those bishops and the archbishops and the pope wears, that is actually a head of a fish from the daggone worship, daggone religion, daggone religion, and that is actually goes back to the Florida lease, and that's a whole other sermon again. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I guess I'm going to go long on this video. So, I haven't even got into my preaching, just trying to do some teaching. In love, brothers and sisters, in love. So, I started questioning that and asking that, and then we had a woman who was a singer in the church, a choir. She was a visiting singer. And I didn't know that her and her husband and then another man that came with them, that they had a radio show, and they did gospel singing, Southern gospel singing, on this little radio in the middle of nowhere, radio station, WTKO, I think. No, that's not W. Is it WTKO? Maybe it is. 1090 AM in King, North Carolina. They have gospel singing and all this kind of stuff on there, and they invited me to come sing on there, or preach on there. They invited me because I'd never really preached, and let me preach on a radio show every Sunday afternoon after church. And anyway, this woman had seizures. Her name was Sandra. She had seizures, and then I just felt pressed by the Lord to pray with her. And I've told this testimony before, but what happened is, I mean, I'm giving you the alpha of my ministry, and now I'm going to give you the omega of my ministry in this same message. In the beginning of my ministry, there I was, and the Lord was leading me to pray for this woman. Now, I went outside. A bunch of people in the church smoked, including the pastor's wife. She still smokes. Obnoxious, sassy, foul-mouthed woman, cussing and stuff right outside the church door. And, Anyway, so these people, half the people in the church smoked. So they were outside smoking and gossiping this woman who was having seizures in the church. She should go to the doctor. She needs to be on medicine. She's probably just showing off. She's just trying to get attention. Or maybe she's got a demon, all these things. So I said to the pastor, because he believed that she was, you know, and probably need to go to the doctor. She's trying to get attention, all these things. He's right in there with him. And I said, well, why don't we pray for her? I mean, I saw no love. This was all just the old clique, almost all your church. That's why I don't see how anybody can go to any of these churches if they're really a Christian, because it ain't nothing but a bunch of old cliques, social clubs, and, you know, the tares are pulling down the wheat. You can't hardly thrive as wheat in there. Of course, you know, there are people that God sends as salt and light. If you're a strong person, God can send you in there as salt and light. But generally speaking, they're just tearing people down and gossiping people and judging people. And that's, you wonder why. Look, if you see it I pray that the Lord will let you see Christianity the way the world, the lost, see it. I mean, if you look at it from the love of Christ and the heart of Christ, you would never go in, you would never darken the door of a church. Not because you don't want to hear the gospel, it's because people are condemning, judgmental, self-righteous, and then they're the biggest sinners you're ever going to meet. You know, like they say, what's the difference? You know, because I knew some people who were Yankees who moved down. I used to bag groceries in high school, and there were some Yankees who you know, who had come down to there to North Carolina. And, of course, all the neighbors are Baptists, and then they were actually Lutherans. And this old woman, she was a drunk, and I used to bag groceries, and she told me, her name was Maybell. She was an old drunk, and she would come in there buying groceries every week, and she would just be talking junk about these Baptists. These, you know, she was cussing. These Baptists, the only difference between me and the Baptists is they hide their liquor under the cabinet, and then I put mine out and let people know I drink. I tell you what, brothers and sisters, 90% of the time, that's the truth. That's the truth. But, you know, God knows everything. There's nothing hidden that won't be revealed. And that's why I'm making this video, to remind you that you might fool your Lutheran neighbors. You might be fooling your neighbors and your little clique, your little social club. You go to church. You're a pillar of the community. I know a bunch of old Baptists there. Pillars in the community. Oh, we can't leave our church. Yeah, everything you're saying is true, Brother Patrick. And we should come out, and we should start a home church, and we should go do the Lord's will. But we're all caught up because we're pillars of the community. We're all caught up in this social club, this outward appearance, this religiosity. And I'm telling you that time is up, game over, playtime is over. Stop playing with God, because you haven't hid nothing from God. You haven't fooled God. All things will be brought to light. Now, that's the bottom line of the warning for you. You need to repent and stop playing church. I mean, that's really straight up, straight from the Lord, brothers and sisters, because that was nowhere what I was going to say. That's the bottom line right there. That's the summation of it. So anyway, brothers and sisters, stop playing with God. Stop playing religion, you old Pharisees. To those of you who are not Pharisees, well, you know, let it hit where it needs to and let it go on by you if it doesn't apply to you. You know, but I give you a clue. If you're offended, it probably applies. If you're not offended, then it doesn't apply. It's just, that's kind of a big clue. Kind of a big clue. God will either make you mad or make you glad. You know, and then if you get mad, you need to repent so you can get glad. You know. So anyway, that reminds me, I heard that because I don't, you know, Jesse Duplantis is a clown. He is a total clown. And he's just talking this prosperity stuff. But I flipped it over there one night and he was on, because the pastor of that Baptist church I started in, his favorite preacher was Jesse Duplantis. That tells you, you know, that tells you all you need to know about that pastor. So Jesse Duplantis, did you know that every year Jesse Duplantis and John Hagee do a cruise together? You know, and John Hagee and his family, they do all this gospel singing, you know, some Southern gospel singing and all this. And they do that on the boat and all that. For one thing, you know, I'm a Christian, but I'm not a huge fan of Southern gospel, I'll tell you. I like praise and worship and, you know, Pentecostal spirit-filled music. I don't really like this Southern gospel, to be honest with you. Kind of a Baptist type stuff. And for me, it would be the opposite of heaven to be on a ship where they're singing all that Southern gospel. I can't lie to you. Because it's not about the Lord or to the Lord. It's not praising the Lord or to the Lord. It's all about we when we all get to heaven. And, you know, and all that stuff, when the world is caught up yonder, I'll be there. There's nothing against those songs. I mean, sometimes the Lord has put them in my spirit. But it's all about me, and you, and somebody died and all this. And just, it's ministering to our flesh to have joy, but it's not ministering to the Lord. I mean, that's the bottom line with it, to tell you the truth. But let's just be honest. I want to praise the Lord and then worship the Lord. When I sing and praise, it's unto the Lord, not to edify myself, but to edify the Lord. The opposite of what Joel Osteen's wife said. You know, she was just had a controversy the other day where she said, we don't come to church to worship God, but we come to church to get happy. Something like that, what she said. That's the opposite. We come to church not to be happy, but we come to church to worship the Lord. And then as we minister to Him, He pours out His Spirit. The Bible says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty, and where the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of His people. It's two different Bible verses. So as we minister to Him, then He sets us free. Then He blesses us. So the fruit of the Spirit is joy and peace and all that. We don't go to the Lord for joy, but a fruit of going to the Lord because He's holy, righteous, and worthy of our praise, a fruit of is joy and peace and all those things. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, 23, the fruit of the Spirit. Okay, that's another sermon. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so where was I at? Sorry. I haven't even gotten into the message that I wanted to give you. And then I'll try to break it and make a separate message so it won't be so long, and then the people will hear the message, and then, you know, I'll mess it up if I break the sermon. Anyway, so because it's all connected. So where was I at? So let me just run with it here. I talked about, you know, worshiping the Lord and all this. Anyway, so Jesse Duplantis, he said that, you know, John Hagee is mad and I'm glad. You know, together we're like twins. He's mad and I'm glad. So, which is true. I mean, their personalities couldn't be more opposite. I could never see them working together, but it's pretty bizarre. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I want to continue talking to you about, that religiosity and being free from that. So anyway, this morning when I woke up, let me get into what the Lord told me. This morning when I woke up, brothers and sisters, I was thinking, I mentioned this in videos before. I used to lay hands on every single person that wanted to be prayed for. And I have literally prayed with tens of thousands of people, brothers and sisters. We would go to a place, and in a three-day weekend, I would lay hands on 1,000 people in the Philippines, all over the place. Like 300 and something a day. We did medical missions. We had other Filipino pastors who would evangelize each person. And then I would pray with them individually, with a translator, ask them if they understood, the gospel and all that. I would question them and their sickness and disease. I would pray for them to be saved, lead them to the Lord through prayer, and then I would pray for them to be healed. All that stuff. Individually, one at a time. And lots of them were healed. Some of them were not. Some were healed. But they, you know, all of them got to get to that point. They all prayed to receive the Lord. They all experienced the presence of God. You know, by the tens of thousands, brothers and sisters, that I personally laid hands on. I'm saying that so that you will understand that I have experience in that. And the thing is, if those of you who are filled with the Holy Spirit, you will know that you can feel the Holy Spirit flowing from you and back to you. You can feel the flow of the Holy Spirit, kind of like electricity, kind of like water. Sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's cold. Sometimes it's like fire, sometimes it's like ice. It depends on what God's doing. There's different anointings. As a matter of fact, in the Bible it says there are seven. You know, in Revelation is one place, but it says in the Old Testament too, like in Zechariah about the stone with seven eyes on it, which, and then in the book of Revelation it says the seven spirits of God. Now some people say, oh, there's only one. Well, you have to take it up with the Lord. But he said there are seven spirits of God. And then I think, I want to say it's in Isaiah where Dr. Jack Manimpi ties it into the fact there's the spirit of peace, the spirit of, but it's all the one Holy Spirit. But brothers and sisters, these are things we don't fully understand. And nobody fully understands, but really the Holy Spirit, I guess, would say he moves in seven different ways. You know, you have the completion. God uses the number seven for completion. So the Holy Spirit operates in seven different ways. As I said, in the book of Revelation, it says this. There's a stone with seven eyes on it, which are the, you know, the seven, the spirits of God, the seven spirits of God. And it talks about in the Old Testament too, in Zechariah. So, as I said, there's one Holy Spirit, and obviously he operates in seven different anointings, seven different ways. And I haven't studied all that out. Every one, I've looked at them and study over to know, and in my own experience, God moves in different ways. You know, sometimes it's a healing, sometimes it's for conviction of sin, sometimes it's for to bring zeal and boldness on you while you're speaking, all these different kind of things. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that's also a whole nother message. So while I was, this morning when I woke up, the Lord spoke to me, and like I said, I can count on two hands, maybe the people I prayed with, the Holy Spirit would not enter them. Some of the people I pray with, like there's a woman I know, she's been baptized in the Holy Spirit. And then her husband is a Christian, but a Baptist. And I would say when I prayed with him, he received the Holy Spirit about 10%, this one guy. But lots of people who I prayed with who were not received, there's two groups of people I pray with that will receive no Holy Spirit, or just 1% out of 100. That's atheist and Baptist. Atheist and Baptist. Okay. And so the Lord this morning, when I woke up, the Lord gave me the word OHM. OHM. A lot of you guys might know what, men would know what I'm talking about. And OHM is a measurement of resistance. OHM. A measurement of resistance. Like if you've ever had anybody test a circuit, they'll, you know, like in your house, your plug-in's not working, they'll put those two things in there. And it's measuring the resistance. Like if the circuit's broken, then it won't work. But so it sends like a little current in there, and then it measures the resistance to that. So that's a measurement of ohms from this guy named OHM. OHM. Who invented this measurement. And so it's resistance to electricity, you know, resistance to current. So this morning, now this is something that's totally out of the blue that the Lord dropped on me that I would never have thought of. So the Lord was telling me this morning, ohms. So for atheist, I'll just cut to the, you know, to the funny thing that the Lord showed me. For atheist, it's on the way to hell meter, you know, and then for Baptist, it's objection to the Holy Spirit meter, OHM. So that's the things that the Lord gave me this morning out of the blue that I would have never thought of, that makes the Lord so cool, so awesome, and so interesting that he would say these things and make it even funny and in love. So those two groups who I pray with who will not receive the Holy Spirit are very 1%. Many of the Baptists I pray with, they receive just a little bit, but they're very resistant and objective to the Holy Spirit. Objection to the Holy Spirit meter. And I can feel that it's just like 90% it will not go into them. And most of the Baptists I know, who I really know, when I pray with them, the first time can barely receive. And then later on, they become more trusting that, oh, this is the Holy Spirit. Because if someone's really saved, they know the Holy Spirit. I will just say this. If you say you're saved just from a mental assent, old John Wesley, who founded the Methodist, called it mental assent. You're mentally agreeing, yes, you believe Jesus down on the cross and all this. It's all right here. You are not really saved. And don't let, you know, John MacArthur, the Holy Spirit blasphemer, and all these people like him who would say that, oh, you don't rely on experience, you rely on the Word. Let me tell you something. Being a Christian is a personal relationship with Jesus. It is an experience. It's not even about the word. Ultimately, it's not even about the word. It's a personal relationship. The Lord Jesus Christ, God, has a personal connection with us. This is an experience above and beyond the word. The Bible, without the Holy Spirit, the Bible is just another book. But it's the Holy Spirit that empowers the word. You know, the Lord, you invite the Lord to come into your heart and all that. That's through the Holy Spirit. It's not from words on a piece of paper. The words, as the Bible says, the letter of the law brings death, but the Spirit brings life. The Spirit of God breathes life into the word. So we have a personal, if you really got saved, if you have not had a real encounter with God, the Holy Spirit, and you may say Jesus, but God, you had an encounter with God. It's literally the Holy Spirit. Jesus is there in heaven, seated at the right hand of the Father. He manifests himself to us through his Spirit, through the Holy Spirit. Okay. So, you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, the Lord is here. Well, he is through the Holy Spirit. The Lord Jesus Christ is actually seated at the right hand of the Father, forever making intercession for us. He's our high priest, the Bible says. So, when you got saved, you have an encounter with the Holy Spirit, conviction of sin, a desire to repent. The holiness of God, you know, that you're lost, the revelation that you're lost and without hope in this world. And the only opportunity to escape is the crashing plane. The plane's about to crash. And then, then the preacher, like the airline stewardess, says, here's a parachute. Would you like one? The plane's about to crash. Put on this parachute so you can escape this, you know, this crashing airplane. So you put on the parachute of salvation through Jesus Christ. Not get on a plane and, I understand that if the plane ever crashed, we need a parachute. Here's a parachute. I'll put it on. And in theory, if the plane crashes, I can do it. No. That's all here. It's all about getting into a personal experience, encounter with God, to his holiness, his righteousness, to your sin, to love, to the love of God, all those things. Experience with God. That's getting saved. If you haven't had that, then I caution you and challenge you that you need to check your salvation. For the Bible says in Romans 8:16, you know, his Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So his Spirit bears witness with our spirit. We know in our spirit, not in our mind, not by saying, oh, the Bible says all to call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. That's true. That's why our faith is also, you know, in the word. But it's ultimately, I've had the biggest question anybody ever asked me is, you know, I'm not sure if I'm saved and I want to make sure I'm going to go to heaven and all that. The biggest answer is not just keep quoting Bible verses and in your head saying, well, you know, I'm believing that. It's his Spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. You know personally from God, not from me, you know, comforting you and reading you Bible verses. And that's what all this old John MacArthur and all these religiosity denominational people are doing. They're getting you in your head to agree with the word. And standing on it and saying, well, I'm saved because the Bible says I'm saved. No, the Bible says you're saved because his Spirit tells your spirit. And you know in your spirit, man, in your heart. Nobody can come tell you anything different because you know it in your spirit, man. The devil can't steal that from you. As Jesus talked about throwing the seed on the different grounds, you know, the good ground, the rocky ground, the wayside, all that. So he says that when the seed falls by the wayside, then the enemy comes, you know, a bird comes and snatches that seed. The enemy steals the word out of you. But see, even as David said, I have hid the word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Not in your head, in your heart. That's where, you know, my calling is really to these Baptist people, denominational people. That's the calling that I've had from God, my commission from when I started. You got the word here, but it's not here. It's like eating a bunch of bread. The word is the bread. But then you don't wash it down with the Spirit. You know, you got to have water, the Spirit, to wash that word down from here, from your mouth, down into your heart. What does the Bible say to be saved? The Lord's giving me all this. Romans 10, verse 9 and 10. It says, if you will confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God has raised us from the dead, and thou shalt be saved. What does it say? I always misquote that verse. I refuse to memorize that verse. It's always, you know, have you ever had a verse that's kind of annoying to you? To memorize just the way it's worded? That's a great example. Verse, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God is raised from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So you need to believe in your heart for righteousness, and from your mouth for salvation. So both. There are some greasy gracers who say, oh, it's a work if you even say, oh, I believe, you know, say out loud, I believe in you. It's only in your mind to say, yeah, I believe the gospel. That's what it says, with a mouth, confession is made unto salvation. That's why you're supposed to confess your faith. That's why we have altar calls. Come to the front and publicly confess. That's why we have water baptism. That's why God created water baptism. Not that the water is literally washing away your sins. It's like being washed off. The blood of Jesus washes away our sins. But when I publicly proclaim, yeah, I'm saved. Yeah, I identify with Christ. The Bible says we identify with Christ through burial and resurrection. So water baptism is submersion in water to be buried with Christ. The old man is dead on the cross. You get on the cross with Christ. You're buried with him and then resurrected with him. And now we will literally be resurrected with him at the rapture, of course. And then at the end of the age for those who don't go in the rapture. At the end of the thousand-year reign of Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I had lots of other ways I wanted to go with this that I already pre-planned, but the Lord has brought me to this. Anyway, brothers and sisters, this is my question unto you, to denominational people, Baptist and to the right, to the left, to more liberal Lutherans and all, whatever you are, anything outside the tongue talkers, the Pentecostals, Assemblies of God, Church of God, and all that, anybody outside that. There's lots of people that go to the Pentecostal churches. I have an aunt who got healed of a deaf ear in a Pentecostal church as a child. So she's been going to that church since she was grown, but she don't believe in speaking in tongues. She don't believe in any of that stuff, but she was healed in that church. So therefore, she goes to that church for 30 years or whatever it's been, 40 years. But yet, because of the family Baptist, she says, oh, I don't believe in any of that stuff. Sitting right there in the middle of all those Spirit-filled people, healed by them, but yet doesn't believe in it. And as a matter of fact, it was a woman who prayed for her to be healed. And, she, you know, also, she specifically believes also that women don't have a right to pray for anybody, anything else. But yet, one prayed for her and she was healed. I mean, what can you do? You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. I mean, as Abraham told the rich man, you know, even if someone comes back from the dead, your brothers wouldn't believe Moses. They won't even believe if God sends somebody back from the dead. And the Lord did come back from the dead, and they still don't believe the fullness of the gospel. This is what I'm trying to tell you. Okay, though, we know atheists and all that. They are on the way to hell meter. When I prayed for them, they're totally resistant to the Holy Spirit. But the Baptists, they're objecting to the Holy Spirit meter. You know, they're not receiving the Holy Spirit. So it's good and commendable to test every spirit. You know, let me say that. It's good and commendable to test every spirit. But you're so relying on your own mental assent to the gospel that you can't even be moved by the Holy Spirit. And so my question to you is, I've got some questions to you from the Lord. How is it that you can say you got saved and the experience you're supposed to have when you get saved is with the Holy Spirit? You know, all these Baptists are like, they don't like the Holy Spirit. Jesus himself did not come to you when you got saved other than he manifested himself through the Holy Spirit. As I said, the Bible tells us clearly, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. When you experience the presence of God, it's the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit of God that you're experiencing. Jesus is coming through the Holy Spirit to you. However that works, people, you know, killed each other and all this stuff over the way back in those centuries about the doctrine of the Trinity and they're all one, but yet they're different and all that. Who cares? That's where all those people who are debating that, they're the very ones who are not even saved. All these high theologians, they don't even know Jesus. If they knew Jesus, they wouldn't be worried about that crap. They would be focused on the love of God, the gospel, all those things that the Lord would call us to do. By the way, the word crap is a man's last name who invented the flushable toilet. Isn't it Dr. Crapper? That's true. Go look it up. Thank God for Google. Anyway, brothers, the Google, as President Bush would say. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I have a couple of questions for you from the Lord. Number one, how is it that you think you know Jesus or say you know Jesus, but you don't know the Holy Spirit? Just like Jesus asked talk to those old Pharisees. You can look at the sky and see the weather, but you can't discern the signs of the times. So, you know, Jesus himself showed up in Jerusalem and those old Pharisees missed it. They thought they knew God, but when God came in the form of, you know, Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus Christ, God the Son showed up, They missed it. They didn't know who he was. You know why? Because they didn't know God. So when I go to a Baptist church and they don't know the Holy Spirit, how is it that you know Jesus, but you don't know his Spirit? Can you please answer that question? The answer is obvious. Stop throwing stones and stop what you're doing and look in the mirror and see. And see what you see in the mirror. A form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. All right, next question. Acts chapter 19, starting at verse 1. This is going to go long, I guess. Acts chapter 19, starting at verse 1. And it came to pass that while Apollo was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples. Okay, there are people, there's a guy that made a video saying I was a false prophet, okay? Because he said that I believe, that I'm teaching, that you don't, that you don't have to speak in tongues to be saved. You do not have to speak in tongues to be saved. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a further work of the Holy Spirit. I have the same doctrine as the Assemblies of God. If you go look at the doctrinal statement of Assemblies of God, mine is basically the same. Okay, there's a guy who had a special revelation from God. He even said he had a stigmata and all this, and some kind of a whack job, you know, and he's attacking everybody. He was trying to get me to help him go attack everybody on YouTube, and I told him to go jump off a bridge, and then he made a video saying that I was a false prophet, because he says that you have to speak in tongues to be saved. It's not what the Bible says. As a matter of fact, I'm teaching about that we should be filled with the Holy Spirit, but I'm going to use the same text right now to say that you do not have to be speaking in tongues to go to heaven. So what does it say? And finding certain disciples. Paul found some disciples of Jesus Christ, but they had not received the baptism of the Spirit. This is one of many witnesses in the Word of God to show you that you do not have to speak in tongues to be saved. For the other side of this argument, you know, the other side of balance and all this. But now back, I'm working from the other side in this sermon. You know, that you should be filled with the Holy Spirit. You should be open to the things of God, the Holy Spirit. But I just wanted to put that out there because, like I said, there's a guy, if you Google my name, and Google is trying to be controversial. I've looked up about it. And anybody that says anything against you, it always comes up at the top of the Google search. This is not by mistake. They love to start controversy and cause trouble. I ask them, you know, I try to, you know, submit some form to have it as slander and have it taken down, but of course they can't do it. They won't do anything about it. They want controversy. But anyway, this guy just got saved a few months ago, claims he had some special revelation from the Lord Jesus, and all those people think they're Elijah, and that you have to speak in tongues or you can't go to heaven. You know, but I've never even mentioned the guy. I've been ignoring him. He, you know, there's several people that told me, you know, you should tell him it's slander and all that, but what can you do? He's a nut job. Anyway, I turn the other cheek and pray that the Lord would, you know, have him repent of this, him seeing himself as some kind of Elijah, and that he would truly get saved and, you know, take down all of his videos. He's got lots of videos against lots of people. Anyway, when Paul came there in Ephesus, he found certain disciples. Okay, they were Christians. And he said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? And they said unto him, we have not such as heard even that there was a Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, to what were you baptized? And they said unto the baptism of John. Then Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him, which should come after him, that is, on Jesus Christ. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. And all these men were about 12. So there's lots of things I could talk about there about the Holy Spirit. Yes, being baptized in the Holy Spirit is manifested by speaking in tongues and prophesying. Okay? And there's several different witnesses to that all through the book of Acts, like Cornelius' house, Acts chapter 11, Acts chapter 8 in Samaria, several different ones. But excuse me, anyway, that's not the point. What I'm trying to go with this message is to ask you this question. I didn't hear any of those 12 men say, well, you know, I don't need the Holy Ghost to be saved. I don't need to speak in tongues. I saw somebody speaking in tongues, and I thought it sounded like Babel. I think it's from the devil. So no thank you, Paul. Apostle Paul, I don't think I want to speak in tongues. I don't need that because I've been forgiven of all past, present, and especially future sins. So I don't want to be any closer to the Lord than I am. I already got my meal ticket punched. I already got my train ticket to the, you know, that train that's bound for glory. So, hey, I don't need nothing else from God. I don't want to be any closer to God. If I get filled with this Holy Spirit, hey, God may make me be embarrassed in front of people if I spoke in tongues. God may make me look like a fool in front of my little clique, in front of my little peers, in front of my little buddies, because I'm a pillar. I'm a pillar of the community. So I wouldn't dare want to be humbled in front of anybody because I'm somebody in my own eyes and in the eyes of my flunky loser friends. So therefore, I don't need it, so I don't want it. I don't need any more of God than what I need just to get into heaven. I didn't hear any of them saying that. So why is it that 10,000 Baptists have told me basically the same thing that I just said to you? But they said it in a way to justify themselves, to play lawyer, to play on words, to scoop by. And just as the old lawyer said to Jesus, when they asked Jesus, what's the greatest commandments? And he said, you know, to love God and to love your neighbor as yourself. And then the old lawyer, as it says, seeking to justify himself, said, well, just who is my neighbor? You know, and implying that, you know, he should love the guy that's literally his neighbor and his fellow Jews from the tribe of Judah. But he doesn't have to love the Samaritans. He doesn't have to love, you know, black people, Asian people, whatever you want to come up with, you know, who some other people. And that's when Jesus told the parable of the Good Samaritan. Now, in those days, the parable of the Good Samaritan, brothers and sisters, the Samaritans were like the, you know, as I've said this before, the Samaritans were treated like black people were treated in America, you know, before 1960 or whatever, 1960 or 1970. They were the second class people. They treated them, and they were mixed blood people. The Samaritans were there in the place where the Assyrian kingdom in 700 and something BC, the northern kingdoms of Israel, what they some people call the 10 lost tribes, those tribes of Israel were taken, and the Assyrians scattered them, as God said they would be, all over the place. And then they took people from other places and put them there. And then these people from other lands who were not Israelites interbred with the few remaining remnants of the handicapped, the blind, the old people and all that. They interbred. And so they had some Israeli blood. But, you know, the most of their blood was mixed blood. So the Samaritans were like the mixed blood people of that place. And so the tribe of Judah people, since they had, the temple there in Jerusalem and all that, they thought they were better than the Samaritans. The Samaritans were kind of half-breeds, and they thought they were, you know, looking down on them. And so when Jesus told the story of the parable of the Good Samaritan, it's like the Samaritans were like the, you know, the dogs of Israel. They treated them like junk. And then so here is the Samaritan is the one who takes care of the, you know, this special Israelite, this Jew who's injured. Some rabbi doesn't help him. You know, a preacher doesn't help him, all this stuff. And then here is this guy who's like treated like a dog by the Jews, but yet he's the one who helps and takes care of him. So the Lord is like, you know, love your enemies. Take care of those who hate you. That's who your neighbor is. You know, not just your literal neighbor. And so that's the point, brothers and sisters. Stop trying to play lawyer with the Word of God. Stop trying to play lawyer and try to finagle and wiggle your way out of just enough to get by. Now, the Lord knows all these things. Let me tell you what the Holy Spirit does. The baptism of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he said, tarry in Jerusalem. You know that there are people who have the brain power of what? I don't know. They actually believe they need to go in Jerusalem and tarry for 10 days so they can't be filled with the Holy Spirit. Or they believe they got to tarry in their church for 10 days because the original disciples tarried for 10 days. That was the giving. The Holy Spirit was given on the day of Pentecost, and you don't need it to be given again to the world. The Lord already gave the Holy Spirit on Pentecost. We don't need to wait for him to give it again. We just receive it. That's why Paul said in that text, Acts chapter 19, he said, have you received the Holy Spirit? He didn't say, did God have another Pentecost here in Ephesus? No, he didn't say that. Did you receive the Holy Spirit since you believed? Let me look at another text. So the Holy Spirit purpose is for us, is Acts chapter 1, back to what I was saying. Jesus said, you shall tarry in Jerusalem, you know, and then you will receive power from on high to be a witness to me. So the purpose of the Holy Spirit is to be a witness. So maybe you don't want to tell people the gospel. You're saved and let everybody else go to hell. I always sit in the church. We have our little clique. Oh, yeah, I know I'm saved. I'm glad I'm saved. I remember when I got saved. It was 6 p.m. on July the 3rd, 1962, and I was right over there at the altar. I remember when I got saved. Hallelujah, I'm going to heaven. Everybody else is going to hell outside. They're all wrong. They all got the wrong Bible. They're all going to hell. They're all, you know, this, that, and the other. But praise God, we're saved. Close the door to the world. I've been to a ton of those little Baptist churches. I've done revivals in places and little Baptist churches, and somebody that's not a member of their church come in, and you know, no one in the church is under 60 or 70. Some young person tries to come in there. Oh, they're just trying to get money out of us. Oh, they're trying to seduce the pastor. Oh, they're trying to do this. Oh, they're trying to do that. Oh, they're trying to bring in some new doctrine in here, some new fancy smancy newfangled doctrine in here. Dead religion. Dead religion. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, brothers and sisters. Chapter 2. Now this is, if any old dead, spiritually dead preachers will hear me, may the Lord use this to minister to their heart in Jesus' name. Acts chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 through 5. And I, brethren, when I came unto you, came not with exceeding excellency of speech or of wisdom, like John MacArthur, who else has their famous, Adrian Rogers, the late Adrian Rogers, Dr. D. James Kennedy, who is this guy that's so famous now? He's an older guy, I forgot his name now. Oh, people listen to him all the time. You know, I'm just naming these guys because they have such a great voice. They have such excellency of speech. And they have that radio voice, that voice. As I said, these John MacArthur, of course, he has a nasally whiny voice, but he's probably an exception to my example. But lots of these guys, they have this great voice. Who is this guy that everybody loves? I'm trying to think of his name. Anyway, all these guys, they got some great, Dr. D. James Kennedy, as I mentioned, Adrian Rogers. They're loved because they have this such a soothing voice of excellency of speech. I came to you not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God, but I determined not to know anything among you except for Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now that's the verse that the Baptists will use to say why they preach salvation by grace every week and never disciple anybody. That's the verse they use. Let's keep going. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom. Listen to this. Not with enticing words of men's wisdom, like most of the preachers that you're going to see on TV. It's enticing words of men's wisdom. But in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. The word is dunamis, dynamite. Where we get the word dynamite from. Dunamis, the Greek word power. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men. Great, enticing, cool-sounding preaching. But in the power of God, that your faith would not rest in the wisdom of men, but the power of God. Paul didn't come with great talking words like his letters. He talked about how in letters he's such a good writer, but not in speech because he had some kind of a stuttering problem or something. That was his thorn in the flesh, they say. He stuttered and stuff. He couldn't see good. He had lots of some medical issues that the Lord refused to take from him so he wouldn't become arrogant because he was like the most anointed man in the New Testament, him and Peter. But Paul had something as a huge theological education that God used to write two-thirds of the epistles in the New Testament. But anyway, he said that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. He said, I didn't come to you with excellency in speech, but in demonstration of the power of God. I don't understand why people have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. They say because we got the Bible. Did you know to the world this is just another book, brothers and sisters? You could get out, they'll say, you listen to these holy people, they talk about the Bible. They'll say scripture, holy books. You know, the Quran, the Bible, the Vishnu, whatever, Sanskrit writing and all this, whatever, Buddhism, Mohammedism, as they used to call it, Islam, all these different things. It's just another book, brothers and sisters, to the world. It's just another book. When the apostles did their signs and wonders, and Jesus did signs and wonders, they already had the Old Testament. All Jewish males were required to memorize the Torah by the age of like 5 or 6. And then by the time they were 13, they had to memorize the whole Old Testament, the Tanakh. They had to memorize that. They knew it all. Supposed to be that they were trained to do it. All males, by the time their bar mitzvah, is supposed to know the whole thing, the Tanakh. So they knew the Bible, but yet they still needed to see miracles of God. God confirms His Word by signs and wonders. And it's part of the gospel, the full gospel. That's why they call it, Pentecostals and all that, a real good name for it. It's really good. The full gospel. I'm a full gospel. I preach the whole gospel, the whole counsel of God. Let's look at another one. As I've already gone almost an hour, let's keep going. Let's see, where was Paul at Lystra? Let's see, sometimes my Bible's got those little notes. It seems like it was in Acts chapter. Tooling along here, like 16, I'm thinking. 14, 15, 16, somewhere in there. Paul stoned at Lystra. Okay. Acts chapter 14, verse 8. Listen to this. Listen to this. All ye denominational clique people. There sat a certain man at Lystra, impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, and had never walked. Acts chapter 14, verse 8. Verse 9. The same heard Paul speaking, who steadfastly beholding him, and perceiving that he had faith to be healed. Let me back up. I need to read verse 7. Verse 6. Let's start with verse 6. And they were aware of it, and fled unto Lystra and Derbe, cities of Lycaonia, and unto the region that lieth around about. That's Paul and Barnabas. Verse 7. Verse 7, Acts chapter 14, verse 7. And there they preached the gospel. Paul went around all of his life after he got saved, preaching the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, right? Oh, listen to this. And there they preached the gospel. And so Paul was in a public place there in Lystra, proclaiming the gospel in the middle of the street with a crowd around, you know. They ended up stoning him there. And there was a certain man at Lystra, impotent in his feet, being a cripple from his mother's womb, who had never walked. The same heard Paul speak. Paul was speaking the gospel. And he steadfastly beholding him, and perceived that he had faith to be healed, and said with a loud voice, stand up upright on thy feet. And he leaped and walked. The people saw what Paul had done. They lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of Lyconian, the gods have come down unto us in the likeness of men. So the people took it the wrong way. They thought they were gods instead of, you know, that it was God who did it, the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul was preaching the gospel, and the man got the faith to be healed. Now, if I told you John 3:16 and preached to you a Baptist sermon of the gospel, how would someone have even the inkling or idea that they could be physically healed? Unless I said, God can heal you and demonstrate and prove to you that this book is different from all the other books you might read. This book is different than the Quran. This book is different than the all these other holy books that people might have, what Buddha said, the Vishnus and all this, what Hinduism said, the Vishnus and all these things. This book, the Bible is different. Jesus Christ rose from the dead. He did miracles, and he does miracles. He's not the God who I was or will be. He is the great I am. I am your healer. I am Jehovah Rapha, your God, your healer. I am Jehovah Jireh. God is your provider, not I was. I'm the great I was in the days of the Bible. That's what Baptists are saying. God was the great I was. God did great things 2,000 years ago. Here's a book about it. Now believe what happened 2,000 years ago in your mind. No, that's not what the Bible says. God says, I am. I am. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the good shepherd. To you, not the good shepherd to the apostles, the good shepherd to all his people. Anyone that calls upon the name of the Lord becomes our good shepherd. He is the healer. He is, I am the healer. I am the deliverer. I am the Savior. The Lord is that today, right now, in this moment. If you need to be physically healed, if you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, in the fullness of the Holy Spirit, you want to operate in the fullness of the Holy Spirit? Do you want to have power to be a witness for the Lord? Do you want to be used by God to bring glory to His name? Do you want to have the power to overcome the sin in your life? The power to overcome sin is not your will. Oh, it's using your will to overcome, you know, trying to quit smoking, trying to quit drinking in your own flesh, in your own will. No, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. It's by the power of the Holy Spirit that God heals us. It's by the power of the Holy Spirit that God delivers us. He is the great I am right now, today. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God, hallelujah. Bless your holy name, Father. Bless your name, King of kings and Lord of lords. Hallelujah. Father, we come in agreement right now, Lord, that you've already given salvation after your resurrection. You've given the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Lord, you gave healing to us. By your stripes, we are healed. We were healed, Lord. And now, Lord, we receive salvation in the name of Jesus. We receive deliverance from our sin. You said those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. We receive it right now, not 2,000 years ago. We receive it in our life right now. You are here with us. You are the great I am. You are in us, to us, and through us, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we receive healing right now, today. You are the great I am. We receive healing in Jesus' name. We receive deliverance in Jesus' name. We receive the filling of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Our brothers and sisters, I'm going to do more videos about people being filled. Do you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? I'll specifically get into that. I'm just trying to lay out. This is a summation. Oh, yeah. If you've watched this to the end, wow. God bless you. Listen, this is so amazing. You know, too, when I looked up the word OHM, I looked up the OHM on the internet. I put it through to Google, and I saw that the symbol of OHM is the Omega. And that's, you know, that's really the capstone of it. The end of all things is either, you know, on the road to hell meter, that you're rejecting the Lord completely, or you're objecting to the Holy Spirit meter. You've rejected the third member of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. How can you have Jesus and the Father without the Holy Spirit? And to Pentecostals, how can you have the Holy Spirit without the Lord Jesus Christ and without His Word? You know, that's what these New Age people, they have a Spirit, but no Jesus. You know, they have, and you know, that's a flip side. I need to make a video about that. You know, they have spirituality, like Oprah, remembering your spirit. They have spirituality, ends up New Age, right? You know, and there are people in the, who try to be Pentecostals, but they're really New Age. They throw out Jesus, and they just have spirituality. So if you've got Jesus, you need to get filled with the Holy Spirit. If you've got, you know, trying to be spiritual, you need Jesus. Any other way of entering into the spirit realm, this is a whole nother sermon. Any other way of entering into the spirit realm, this is balance. You know, there's only one gate to enter into the spirit realm. There's only one gate to speak in tongues. There's only one gate for, discernment of spirits and all those things. It's through the gate of Lord Jesus Christ. He said in John chapter 10, He is the gate. He's a lawful. You can only lawfully enter the spirit world through Jesus Christ. All other entering of the spirit world through yoga, chanting, mantras, you know, this whirling dervishes. Did you know that whirling dervishes, you know, trying to levitate and all that, they're actually from Islam. They are a branch of Islam. Most people don't know that. The whirling dervishes. And all these kind of witchcraft, you know, whatever you want to call it. In the Philippines, they call them quack doctors. You got witchcraft, voodoo, all this stuff. Those are unlawful, unauthorized entrances into the spirit world. And there are things like that. And then they try to muddle themselves. Those terrorists try to muddle themselves with in the Pentecostal movement. And then on the other end, you've got your old dead religious Pharisees, you know, who are terrorists, trying to pull down on the other end. And I thank God Almighty, brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, you know, thank the Lord He kept me out of the ditches of these things. Either the ditches on the side, each side of walking with the Lord. And I thank the Lord for that. And that's why, you know, even though I do not promote denominations and I'm non-denominational, but like I said, I came from Assemblies of God. I didn't tell my whole testimony in this video after I left the Baptist church because I was filled with the Holy Spirit. When I prayed for that woman to be healed, I kept praying for her to be healed. And she was healed. I fasted for 3 days and she was healed of seizures. And Sandra, Sister Sandra, and one of those gospel singers I was talking about earlier. And, you know, but before that, I kept praying, Lord, use me in the gift of healing. And then some of the people that came with her, I didn't know they had come from Church of God. And He gave me a word from the Lord, anointed me with oil, and gave me a word from the Lord. And said, the Lord said to me, basically, I can't remember everything because I never heard anything like that. Never heard you could get a word from the Lord. Really, I didn't know. And He's like, the Lord says you've been desiring the gift of healing, which I had been. I didn't tell these people. I didn't tell anybody. So He spoke what I'd been praying. So I was like, got my attention. This is from the Lord. He said, but first the Lord said you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I didn't know exactly what that meant. But anyway, the Holy Spirit came on me a few minutes later. I was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and I could tell my testimony all about that. It's a whole other video. Anyway, I prayed for her to be healed. I prayed for all the people in the church that night when I received the Holy Spirit. All the people in the church came to the front one by one. For 2 hours, I prayed with all. There was like 65, 70 people in there, one at a time. All of them got their answers, their prayers answered, and healings and all that stuff. From alopecia, loss of hair, all kinds of different stuff. Allergy to fish. Someone had this allergy, you know, rash all over their body from fish. They were healed instantly in the church. All these kind of things. And then the next week, the pastor started preaching against, speaking in tongues, the Holy Spirit. So I left and went to Assemblies of God. The Lord led me to go to Bible school through Assemblies of God denomination. Anyway, that denomination was created to bring balance between, you know, Baptist and Pentecostals, really. And that's, you know, thank God. I know now that's why the Lord brought me there, because there's a balance there, brothers and sisters. You don't want to get off in some tangent in the ditch of becoming spiritual without the Word of God, being rooted and grounded in the Word. Or you don't want to be all Word and no Spirit. You know, it's like I said, it's like eating a bunch of bread and not. And can you imagine if you eat a bunch of dry bread and no water to wash it down into your stomach? It's going to get choke you up right here, choke you out. As it says about the, you know, the seed that falls among the stony ground, you know, that persecution comes along, the cares of life, and chokes it out. That's what happens. That's why all these people fall away. They, you know, they don't have the empowerment of the Holy Spirit to maintain their walk with the Lord. And then people who think that you can just do whatever you want and you're still saved, well, of course, they don't see the urgency or the need to have the Holy Spirit, because they just want to get their ticket punch and walk their own way. And guess what? It ultimately, you can even put it this way. Instead of even talking about doctrines and all these things, just put it this way. You think you can fool God? Like I said in the beginning, you think you can trick God? You think you can, you know, just play with God and get your ticket punch and go do what you want? It's not even a matter of people who are once saved, always saved, and they got saved and then they're backslidden. It's the fact that you pre-planned to do that. You know, there are people who are backslidden who didn't pre-plan that. That wasn't the intent of their heart. You know, and that's, you know, God is a judge of all these little details. But I want to say this. There's lots of people who pre-plan to get their ticket punch and live like hell, do their own will, and don't give a care about the Lord, and they think they're going to heaven. God knows the thoughts and intents of your heart. And that's the people I'm talking to. Keep playing. Keep trying to be a part of a social club. There ain't no cliques in heaven. There's only one clique, and that's the followers of Jesus Christ. God bless you guys. Love you guys. And please message me. I need to go back and do videos on all these different topics. God bless you guys.